identification from multi-strain sequencing data.
Hi. So I'm going to be talking about doing this lineage identification from short read sequencing data. So let's take a look at what we are trying to accomplish here. So let's imagine now that we have this kind of plate culture where we have some strains of some bacterial species coexisting together in there. And for whatever reason, we happen to be interested in trying to identify what sort of strains do we have growing on our plate. And we want to do this by using sequencing. So the typical approach on how to do this nowadays would be to look at the plate, and then you see all these individual colonies living on it. So let's just isolate them and put them on their own plates and, okay, grow them for a while on there, and then we can sequence from these plates and then use whatever analysis we like to identify what strains we have living on these plates, and then we'll just say that, okay, these were also living on the original plate. But if we take a step backward and think about the original plate for a while now here, so what if we could just take this plate and rather than trying to isolate the colonies, which is, can be problematic at times, we'll just take the plate here and then sweep everything that lives on it and sequence directly from that and then do whatever we like or actually develop some method to do the identification from those mixed reads. So they can be very messy, and for that reason, we are now focusing on my talk and my method for doing this identification on species where we can culture them first to obtain enough reads to differentiate between the different strains, and also which are well characterized in terms of having a lot of reference data available, so we can leverage the reference data to do this sort of identification in a way that seems to work out pretty well. So we've developed this kind of pipeline for going about doing this. You see the plate here again, and it all starts by just taking the plate here and then sweeping it and sequencing it to produce the reads, and then we get the reference data that I just mentioned, and we'll just go ahead and say, okay, let's take the references and let's align the reads and just hope that it works out. Well, it doesn't really. So with bacterial strains, there's this kind of problem that the genomes are very similar to each other. So if we take a read from, one strain and map it to, say, 1,000 reference genomes from the same species, it's going to align to a lot of them. And we don't really have any idea what's the correct one because it only came from one. So we need to do something on top of these alignments. And we'll especially consider now going with this kind of probabilistic sense in the sense that we'll try to assign proportions to the reference sequences and say that this reference is maybe more likely to be the correct one here than the other one. But that's still not quite there. So, okay, now we get a little bit better prediction and we'll see that, okay, yeah, it's more strongly associated with those two. But it's still two and we'd like to assign it to just one. Well, turns out that there's not much point in going further in here, so instead we'll do something else. We'll just take the most closely related strain sequences here, and let's group them together so we get these lineages which are very related to each other and somehow biologically meaningful, hopefully. So, for example, we could do use sequence types or clonal complexes. And we'll just build a probabilistic model on top of that to infer the proportions on the lineages rather than the strains. And this turns out to work very well, actually. So we are able to say now that the read is very strongly associated with this one lineage, and it's probably the one where it came from, so some sequence that belongs to this lineage. And we get pretty deep within the species if we do it this way. So how this works now is I mentioned that we are using this probabilistic model. So a similar model has been used in a lot of studies concerning RNA sequencing data and transcript expression estimation. It's a very similar problem. But those studies are usually concerned with having just one reference sequence per group to align against. And since we want to align against everything we have so we can fully leverage our reference data, then we need to adopt this model to handle this kind of observations where we have vectors which consist of alignment counts in these lineages. And, well, that can be handled in this model through the likelihood term over there. So there's a couple of modeling or technical variables related to constructing the mixture model, and then we have the likelihood term, which then takes into account the fact that we are aligning against many representative sequences from each group. And in the interest of time, I won't go into further detail on how this model actually works, and instead I'll just try to convince you that it works. So we first went to this kind of problem setting where we just have one lineage in our sequencing reads, so there are other methods to identify where, in which lineage this truly belongs to, so we can just easily compare against it. And okay, we took a few other methods and just said, can we identify the lineage properly? And well, turns out that the other methods, not really, but with ours it's fairly good, except one case, which is a little special. And then, yeah, seems to work nicely. But what's happening outside of the true one? So how big errors do we make in the lineages that are not present? Because this is probabilistic, so we're going to have some abundance in there as well. So it's very, very similar to the other one. So we're doing a very great job in the case that we have one lineage in our sample. But that's very boring, so we'd like to have multiple. And that's actually where it gets interesting, in the sense of interpretation. So, well, it's hard to culture the bacteria and know the proportions that you have in there. So we just mix these single lineage samples together so we know what we have in there and the proportions also. And then we estimate again and look at the errors we make in the clusters that are not present in our samples. And we compare them to the errors that we make in the samples that have just a single lineage in them. And as you can see, they are very similar distributions in the sense that we don't make much of an error in these cases either, where we have three lineages. So it's kind of seems that it's working fairly nicely, and I convinced myself, so hopefully you as well. And then we just moved to applying this to real data. So we got these kind of plate sweeps from Vietnamese children who came to a hospital with diarrhea. And then they were sequenced when they had the diarrheal episode, and then came in again when they were asymptomatic. So we got these paired samples from each child, and we cultured for E. coli. So we kind of want to see what's the E. coli population structure at these two time points. And now here's the results. So each column is now a paired sample of one child, and each row is now a lineage of within E. coli. So blue means that it's more abundant in the asymptomatic samples, and red is just that it's less abundant. And we see this kind of massive shift. I don't know what's causing it, but this massive shift in these lineages. So we have quite a few lineages that completely disappear as appear in the new samples, and then a few lineages that are kind of present in both. So there's not much change in that. I don't really know the biological part of what's happening here, but that's something that someone else who is more knowledgeable in these things can interpret, maybe. And one more thing, we also looked at the antimicrobial resistance content and found that there was, in that sense, also not much of a change in these, between these two points, which is surprising to me. And with that, I'll just like to acknowledge all the people who worked with me on this project. It's quite a few. And just mention that there's a preprint available for this method, and also all the code is available in GitHub, and we also provide the reference for the E. coli and Klebsiella pneumoniae and Campylobacter jejuni species. So thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Time for one quick question.
Hi, do you have any evaluation or idea of how robust the method is if you have strains for which you don't have a reference?
Yeah, I guess in the sense that if we don't have any references for the strains, then the reads that belong to those will most likely just be filtered out. Or if there are related ones, then they will be assigned to those. So it can be problematic. It depends on the evolutionary distance between the references and the ones that we don't have references for. So it might work or it might not. It's a very vague answer.
Okay, thank you very much again. Okay, and the last talk in the morning session will be by Wataru Iwasaki, talking about meta-epigenomic analysis